Hello, friends, and welcome to Carnivore Talk, where we talk about how to lose weight, reverse disease, and all the many benefits of an all-natural, carnivore-centric way of eating. You can find support for your personal health journey here on this channel and from the many wonderful community members over at carnivoretalk.com. Now, please take a moment to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and share it in your social media groups so we can set the record straight on some prevailing medical myths. Now, some myths just won't die, regardless of all the mounting studies and information that should really put such myths to rest. One of these myths is that a high-protein diet will damage your kidneys. For over half a century, there have been many people, including nephrologists, suggesting that we should all consume a low-protein diet in order to optimize our kidney function and prevent kidney disease. How did this myth come to be? Well, it stems from recommendations for people with chronic kidney disease. The fear has been, and still is, that a high-protein diet could potentially be harmful to kidney health because the kidneys are responsible for filtering and excreting the byproducts of protein metabolism. When you consume protein, you produce nitrogenous waste products such as ammonia and creatinine, which are excreted through the kidneys and through the urine. So, individuals with CKD have been told to minimize their protein consumption, which in turn would reduce these waste products, which in turn, in theory, would reduce the burden on the kidneys. This was a hypothesis that sounded reasonable and logical at the time. But over time, this was extended to healthy individuals with the thinking that a low protein diet would also be preventative towards getting chronic kidney disease in the first place. However, recent research and expert consensus suggests that a high protein diet does not harm kidney function in healthy individuals. A team of researchers led by Dr. Stuart Phillips published a meta-analysis that included 28 studies with over 1,300 participants. The researchers were only interested in studies that compared high-protein diets to low-protein diets, and only randomized control trials were eligible. And they only used studies where they measured at the subject's glomerular filtration rate, or GFR. To be considered a high-protein diet, the subject had to consume at least 20% of their daily calories from protein and at least 100 grams of protein per day. To be considered a low-protein diet, subjects had to consume 5% or less of their daily calories from protein. So then, what did the research reveal? High-protein diets do not cause damage to healthy kidneys. The team looked for changes in GFR, which is used as a metric as to how well the kidneys are functioning. Their findings were that there was no change in GFR between the high-protein and the low-protein subjects, and they concluded that the consumption of a high-protein diet had no negative impact on kidneys in healthy individuals. And, in an interesting twist, the data even indicated that not only are high-protein diets safe for kidneys, but they might even be protective. Dr. Phillips said, "The fact is, however, that there is just no evidence to support this hypothesis. In fact, the evidence shows the contrary is true. High protein increases, not decreases, kidney function." As humans, we can not just eat, but we can feast on high amounts of protein, and our bodies utilize this in amazing ways. Now, the best sources of protein are animal-based proteins. When we're hungry, we're basically craving protein. Protein plays a vital role in many bodily functions. It's necessary for building and repairing tissues, producing hormones, enzymes, and maintaining a healthy immune system. To say we should not eat protein or minimize our protein consumption to just a trace, it really just doesn't make sense. Yes, we will produce more ammonia, more nitrogen, and more creatinine as a result. But managing these waste products in our blood is exactly what the kidneys are designed to do. What though if you have chronic kidney disease? Now, for the record, know that I personally have stage 4 chronic kidney disease, and I've been doing a carnivore diet most of the time, about 97%, over the last 14 or 15 months. If you watched my introduction video, you know that I have cherry trees and apple trees that I will pick at, but not harvest, for the week or two that they're in season until the deer have come and grabbed everything within reach. And then maybe once every 2 months, I might end up in a dining situation, whether at a restaurant or a house of a friend who invited me over for dinner. And so as not to be that guy, I might revert back to keto for that meal, usually out of respect for the one that prepared it, extended me that hospitality, and was even mindful to try and cook something, knowing that I have this desire to try and eat healthy. So the boilerplate recommendations for chronic kidney disease are somewhat strange. Usually, like we've discussed, the recommendation is to severely limit your protein consumption as your kidney function declines from stage 2 to 3A to 3B and to 4. And then suddenly when you hit stage 5, now they want you eating tons of protein. Well, this is because as you pass through the stages, you most likely are spilling more and more protein in your urine. Normal kidneys will salvage that protein and put it back into the bloodstream. So think about this. You're already spilling a good portion of protein that you take in. And then on top of that, they want you to barely consume any protein at all. And yet protein is an essential nutrient for repairing tissue, such as kidneys, and keeping your immune system strong. Well, trying to reconcile all this conflicting information when your life could be on the line, it's not a fun position to be in. So I chose to give the carnivore diet a chance. Why? Well, when I was diagnosed with stage 4 chronic kidney disease back in 2000, I was very obese. My nephrologist said that losing weight would help take some of the burden off the kidneys. And so at that time, I decided to return to low carb because in my life, these ketogenic diets were really the only diets that ever worked for me. I had a creatinine level of 3.83, which in turn gave me an estimated GFR or EGFR of 18. Over the course of the next year, I dropped from 232 down to about 195, and I would have my blood checked every 3 months because I refused the biopsy. And it was gradually coming down. My creatinine went from 3.8 to 3.7 to 3.6, and even got as low as 3.45. My EGFR, in turn, increased from 18 up to 21. And I was feeling pretty excited, especially since I was told that those numbers can only ever get worse. Or, if you're lucky, they might stabilize, but they never improve. But my numbers were indeed improving. But in the late summer of 2022, I either broke my toe or had a serious case of gout, I'm not sure, but it sure hurt to walk. That stopped my exercise routine, and before long, I was throwing caution to the wind and eating anything that I wanted again. And by December of that year, I gained all my weight back, and my creatinine had jumped up to 3.57, and my EGFR dropped to 20. I didn't like seeing those changes. So over the next couple months, I tried to gradually get myself back into that diet mentality, starting up at low carb again in March, and then going clean keto or ketovore in April. And finally, on May 12th, 2023, the day I broke my ankle, that's when I went carnivore. Well, around this time, I had watched some carnivore YouTube videos and listened to some carnivore podcasts that interviewed both men and women who had reversed their chronic kidney disease by a few levels. One person went from stage 5 to stage 2, another from stage 3B to stage 1, and then I got to talk to people who were online in these various keto and carnivore communities who were lucky enough to go from their own late-stage renal disease to having perfectly healthy kidneys. Could this be the miracle I was looking for? Well, Yes and no. I had reversed my prediabetes, improved my blood pressure. The issues I had with falling asleep randomly at midday, even while driving, along with my brain fog, skin tags, and ulcerative colitis, those all disappeared. But my chronic kidney disease is the only thing that I have not been able to significantly reverse so far. My nephrologist and I, we run a battery of tests, and we've determined that I am not causing any further damage to my kidneys, and I currently have his blessing to continue on the carnivore diet. If we were looking solely at serum creatinine, and that's the creatinine in your blood, it would look like things were getting worse since starting my strict carnivore diet. My creatinine levels have steadily climbed upward, going from 3.82 up to 4.1, and then even peaking at 4.64 before starting to come back down again. When you use these creatinine values to calculate my EGFR, my EGFR is now down to a 15. That's scary to look at on paper. And my BUN has risen exponentially as well. Well, in most situations, this would usually mean that one is entering transplant territory. A person with an EGFR of 15 should feel sick, have low energy, loss of appetite, itchy skin, and perhaps several other symptoms. But I feel fantastic. I've never had any of these symptoms at all. I do struggle with balancing my electrolytes, but honestly, if it wasn't for some routine blood test back in 2020, I would still have no clue to this day that I had stage 4 chronic kidney disease. Now, it's actually quite natural and understandable that these numbers would go up. I'm eating a high protein diet. Therefore, I am breaking down more protein and producing more metabolic waste in the form of creatinine and nitrogen. Since my kidneys are indeed impaired, the rate with which I can filter out these waste products is slower, and so they do build up in my blood. But this does not necessarily equate to even more kidney damage. But I think this is why the mainstream medical advice is what it is. Those lab values are used as a metric to determine kidney health. When they are not within their normal range, it indicates kidney damage. And the greater those values, the greater the damage, usually. There are exceptions. My high protein diet is actually inflating my creatinine levels. Conversely, if I were to stop eating meat and revert to eating fruits and vegetables, in time, my creatinine levels would go back down to where they were just over a year ago. It would appear that my kidneys are getting better, but this wouldn't be true. It's just a reflection that I'm not eating protein like I was. And I'm not making this up. Kidney.org even says that eating large amounts of meat can lead to higher creatinine levels, making your EGFR number appear lower than it actually is. And conversely, following a vegan or vegetarian diet will lead to lower creatinine levels, making your EGFR number appear better than it actually is. Bodybuilders often have the same issue. They break down protein through tearing their muscles when working out, and at the same time, they could be consuming protein shakes or creatine, which in turn will raise the level of creatinine in their blood. Many bodybuilders will get a blood test and then freak out thinking that they're damaging their kidneys when they're actually not. They're simply eating protein, doing their thing, inflating their creatinine levels beyond that of a normal person. Now, my other labs demonstrate that I'm not doing any further harm. My urine creatinine and urine protein levels have stayed constant this whole time, indicating that my filtration rate has remained the same. Other metrics that are part of a standard renal panel, such as hemoglobin, hematocrit, and albumin, to name a few, they remain beautiful. My labs also demonstrate that my kidneys are utilizing vitamin D better than they have in the last 4 years. Now, there is one lab that is not part of your standard renal panel, but could be very valuable for you, and that is cystatin C. Cystatin C is another way to calculate an estimated glomerular filtration rate, or EGFR, and is actually considered to be more accurate. My EGFR, when calculated using cystatin C, is actually 23, higher than it has ever been when calculated using creatinine. And so for now, my nephrologist says that he is not concerned about me one bit, and I can continue to carnivore on. I'm not showing any signs of doing further damage to my kidneys, and in fact, a few metrics have actually improved, albeit slightly. Now, will I ever succeed in reversing this? I don't know. I don't have high expectations, actually. Kidneys heal slow, if at all, and it often depends on what is the underlying cause of the kidney damage. So what did cause my kidney damage? I don't know either. The most common causes are type 2 diabetes, which I technically did not have, but I think I was definitely headed that way. I was definitely insulin resistant, and I ticked several of the boxes for having metabolic syndrome. The second most common cause is hypertension, which I did have, but only for maybe 6 months or so before finding out I had stage 4 chronic kidney disease. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, or NSAIDs, such as ibuprofen and naproxen, they're the third most common cause, but I was never really into painkillers. So I actually have two prevailing theories. I used to have ulcerative colitis. It turns out that the toxins in coffee were triggering my immune system to attack my colon, and I was a pot-a-day drinker. When I quit coffee, my symptoms vanished, and I was able to get off my medications. One of the theories is that my immune system was not just attacking my colon, but was attacking other organs as well, such as my kidneys. I've actually found studies that link coffee consumption with kidney issues. My second theory is closely related, and that is that the medication I was taking for ulcerative colitis caused permanent damage to my kidneys. I was on dipentin, also known as mesalamine, for close to a decade, and I have also found studies linking mesalamine with irreversible kidney damage. And the truth is, it could be a combination of all these things. Mesalamine, coffee, hypertension, prediabetes, metabolic syndrome. But for now, I'm doing amazingly well on the carnivore diet, and I have no plans to return to my previous eating habits that caused me so much harm and a host of health issues. Today, I'm thriving with my carnivore-centric, most of the time truly carnivore, way of eating. So please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel, and feel free to share this video with anyone who is afraid that a high-protein diet is going to harm their kidneys. And if you know someone who also has chronic kidney disease, please share it with them. I'm very open to answering questions regarding the carnivore diet and chronic kidney disease. Now, if you're struggling with weight or chronic health issues, I truly believe that you would benefit from a carnivore or carnivore-centered diet. We can help you with any questions that you might have over at carnivoretalk.com. And if you have had success on the carnivore diet, or even a carnivore-ish diet, please reach out to me in the show notes below so we can enjoy some carnivore talk with one another. My name is Bob, and I'll see you soon.